Thank you very much. A thousand, I'd like to thank zannat Knowledge City College for inviting me, and of course the Students Association NASA for such a wonderful organization, such a wonderful gathering. And I'm really honored, and it's my pleasure to be there today. If I had something like a hand, change my life. Only this one. Okay. Oh, I can take with my hand? Oh, sorry. I'm not good at computer. Oh, thank you. I will discuss a few things. Of course, my personal journey to architecture is important. And my starting as an architect also is like a lot of students have been. I have designed my lecture in that manner. As we know that globalization is something we started quite long back, 1850s around with the industrialization, but it coined, it probably became predominant mid of the 20th century as the globalization as a term. And we were expecting, we were hoping positively that things should be globalized, all the respect and trust and financial equity, equilibrium will be globalized properly. And we will globalize love, flower, and so many things. But we have seen in the process what we have globalized. We have globalized disrespect and distrust. And financial disparity. We globalized armaments. No love, no respect. And then we found gradually this scenario in September 2015 at the peak slab of the place of globalization. Because migration is a normal phenomenon. The beginning of the history, from the animal to human being, it happened regularly. But now you see the migration is a symbol of destruction of humanity and death. So there are people actually who are really working hard to make this world beautiful, make this world livable, lovable. But today, here, I am not with the manifestation to describe how to change the world to make it livable for the whole universe. Just like Jalaluddin Rumi, a 12th century philosopher, mystic minister, poet, he said, yesterday, I was clever, and I wanted to change the world. And today, I'm wise. I'm changing myself. And changing myself is actually not a simple task. Changing myself, we can remember huge amount of people who are great people like Buddha or Michelangelo, or people like this, who really changed themselves, who made themselves a true human being, who are capable, and who can inspire other people, and who will be changing the world around. So one of my very favorite watercolor painters, I used to do watercolor. So he once talking to me and told me that you do architecture, and architecture should be like your watercolor. It should be transparent. It should be just a watercolor. You can see layers after layers. And finally, you can see the ground. You can see the page paper. Or in architecture, you can see the land and the landscape. So that is very important for me. I was very fascinated actually. And it's true that we need to understand whatever we would like to do, maybe writing or whatever, a painting, we need to understand the landscape where we are working. This is not an important question that what you are doing, or this is important, I think, where you are doing. So where is the question that you need to understand the landscape. As you know, twisting the globe, this 23 and a half degree, made everything magical in the world. The season changes, the sunlight changes, day changes, temperature changes, everything just because of a shifting of 23 and a half degree equation. And that's the reason why we call it from equator 23 and a half and 23 and a half is a tropical area. That means it gets maximum light, it gets maximum rain, it gets, you know, the beautiful soil, the water in the soil, moisture, and it helps whole climate to grow in a fascinating manner, which is not possible or less possible beyond the line of tropics and line of Capricorn. So, my country, Bangladesh, where it is actually? We can see Bangladesh, portion of the Bangladesh, 50% the southern part is in the tropics, and 50% north part is away from the tropics. That makes Bangladesh is a fascinating country, because anything you see on the threshold is really beautiful. Look at the evening. You can't call it a day. You can't call it a night, because it is in the threshold, and it is the most beautiful part of the time, and it exists very, its existence is very fragile and vulnerable, like in the morning, similarly. Of course, you like the sea beach, which is neither a land nor a water. It is in between. Something in between is always fragile and vulnerable and very beautiful. How Bangladesh is beautiful, that I'm going to share with you. In the summer, you know, the wind comes from the Bay of Bengal, which is on the south and southeast. So we have a beautiful monsoon wind coming from southeast. And after the monsoon, after the summer, when monsoon comes, the global wind starts from southwest. And from southwest, the heavy wind starts pouring the rain in Kerala first. And very specifically is Kovalam Beach, where the rain starts falling. And which is almost like 3000 millimeter rain started with Kovalam Beach, and it starts moving up through Bangladesh, and in Dhaka capital it goes down 2000 millimeter, and then further in Sylhet it goes up 3500 millimeter, and ends up with Cherrapunji, 12,000 millimeter rain, which is the highest rainfall in the world. So look at the curve, it's like a music, and pouring rain musically. And Kerala, that's like, is a land of rain. And then simultaneously, the ice melting from the Himalayas, which is north and west, and of course from Brahmaputra, from Assam, two rivers coming down simultaneously in the monsoon, and the whole water coming through the Ganges plain to Bangladesh, and finally ends up in the Bay of Bengal. So Kerala is a country of rain, and Bangladesh is a country of water. This is how our land works, and the beautifulness, the beauty of Bangladesh, I can understand through this way. So let me share the beauty, the poetry of Bangladesh. That, let's talk about water a little bit onward. Bangladesh is the largest delta on earth, having more than 50 major river channels coming down from Himalayas through an intricate pattern through Bangladesh towards the Bay of Bengal. That's why I call Bangladesh, sometimes BBC and CNN previously we saw talking about Bangladesh a country of toil, a country of, you know, pain. But I love to say Bangladesh is a country of poetry. How poetry comes? In the monsoon, when the two-thirds of the country's land is inundated, you know, completely inundated by water. And it looks like the water becomes a major element of landscape. And after just 2 months, when water starts receding, it leaves behind a fine layer of alluvial soil, and after one and a half month, entire landscape transforms into large patches of paddy field, and then dancing with the waves. This is how I call it. Bangladesh is a country of poetry. And that inspires me to become a watercolor painter. Now you understand my source of inspiration. In 1976, at the age of 13, I received Jawaharlal Nehru Memorial Gold Medal for my painting. And I thought, I'm going to be an artist, definitely. I didn't know about architecture. What is architecture? I didn't have any idea. So I was pursuing myself as an artist. So I had a lot of stages at the time to learn and to go for the Institute of Fine Arts at the time, gradually. So these are some of the examples of my stages. In the rail station, whole night spending. So today's lecture is almost like, I would like to say, like a bold journey I'll take you through to understand how I work, how I entered into architecture, and how I'm studying yet as an architect. I'm sorry, this is, I'm not good at moving things. So this is the old Dhaka, you see, where I actually born and brought up. And this is some sketches you can see. This is one narrow alley in old part of Dhaka. It's very familiar to me. And this is, you know, when I wanted to be an artist, my father, he was very, very unhappy. He wanted me to be something else, like a lawyer or at least an engineer or something like that. And I was very frustrated because he was completely against of this sort of becoming a painter. So I was looking for some aperture, what needs to be done. And one of my cousins, she told me that there is a subject called architecture. And that belongs, at that time, the University of Engineering and Technology. So you can try for it and your father will be very happy to know that you are going for engineering university. So I tried for that. Luckily, I got admitted. And my father was really happy that I'm going to be an engineer. And I knew that I have nothing to do with engineering. I want to continue my painting journey. That's all. And very quickly, I found in the first year class that all of the students got 9.5 or 9 or 10 out of 10 for the first quarter, and I'm the only guy who got 3 out of 10 in the whole class. So that is the starting point of my architectural journey, and I soon realized that this is not a cup of tea of mine, but I cannot escape because of my father. And the second year, one of my teachers, don't think that all the teachers are saying, one of my teachers told me, see my preliminary drawing, I can't grade you, man, because you are below the failing grade. So you understand my position at that time. I was almost crying almost every day how to get rid of this thing. And in third year, my father, second year in, he died actually. And I wrapped up my architectural journey and I started for my painting journey. So some of my friends and my family has told me tightly that you have more few years and please complete it somehow and then you go for painting. Will I stop you this time. This is how I completed my architectural journey. But after my death of father, we had a house which we used here, 4 old rooms, like 100 years old, a nice courtyard, a small, tiny, beautiful garden with orchards and flowers, and my parents used to, operate this one. And they are always fighting each other, they are always like shouting each other, what plants should be planted, what should be removed from there, and that was their everyday life. And the courtyard was the gathering place of 9 siblings of ours. So all sorts of games used to play over there, and reading and like a library, and few rooms for dining and other functions. This was not enough because my eldest brother is going to marry. So we need rooms. We planned that we need to build a portion existing and rest of the house will be demolished and we build a 2-story house. So we went an architect because I am just 3rd-year student and a 4th student particularly. I cannot design. So we got a design from the architect. And I learned architecture from my mother actually. The day we started discussing with the plan given by the architect to us, after seeing the plan, first reaction of my mother was, where is my courtyard? Where is my garden? And you see, I lost my husband. She says, I lost my husband. Now I see I'm going to lose all my memories. Then how can I survive? And I promised my mother, in a way that, okay, I will give back you your memories. Mama, I'll give you back the memories. So I started designing the first time. And this is the house I designed. The first level, she wanted to stay a little higher, to have more lights and, ventilation. So I produced the courtyard in the middle of the house, and the front court in the first floor level, and this is the first building having hanging garden in our country. So this is the courtyard you can see in the winter morning. Some sketches at the time, 84, 85, and the courtyard in the summer, and the garden on the first floor, which my mother used to enjoy until she was there. Now she passed away last year, this year, early. And this is the garden, a lot of trees are there. cross ventilation, traditional floor. So after this project, I realized after my graduation that architect needs to travel and see and learn from other architects, other society and culture and nature and so on. So I started my tour around Sri Lanka and, you know, India and other parts of the world gradually. So I'll share a couple of my sketches, travel sketches. It's all Jeffrey Bauer. I have almost completed the Jeffrey Bauer tour a couple of times. His office, Colombo office, originally. You can remember this, huh? In Kerala, the monolith or megalith in Thrissur. This is in UPenn, where Vivekan used to teach. This is the building where Vivekan, Pandit's building, he used to teach. He never went with a new architectural building. He hates the building actually. So this is the only building he used to teach, his classes. This is in, I think in Australia, Sydney. This is in Australia, Sydney, with Glen Market. This is Hong Kong. This is in London. This is in Nepal. This is in Malaysia. So I have a couple of friends in Malaysia. Somehow I was working for government of Malaysia. So they offered me, luckily, one project that I can do. So we have done a project, completed project recently in Malaysia, a year back. The problem with the project is this, the land is only 4 acres, not that big, and the Satya headquarters, they are the largest developer in Malaysia and very aggressive. And they tried many architects from New Zealand, from Australia, from Singapore and Malaysia, of course, but they didn't like any project. When I visited the site they offered me, I told them this whole area kept for harvesting is belongs to your site, nobody told you. So always they see the site is small, building is packed, there's no landscape. But I view the whole area actually, and their land is the portion of the whole area, and the building looks not a big one now. So they told me, nobody told us this whole area actually belongs to us, because the whole area is developed by them and preserved for the harvesting. So this is how they are very convinced with the approach and started working on the project. So this is the project I started some of these sketches. I'm not, because a couple of projects I'll be showing, so I go quickly. So this is the project completed now. Because Malaysia, you know, is a tropical, truly tropical country. So I put a huge parasol on top, which will be shading mostly most of the parts of the building. And this is how it works. The green roof. And the whole water body is basically a parking area. You can see the parasol edged by the frosted glass. This is very important to understand. Look at the creation. A tree is coming out as huge and branching out thinner and thinner, and then finally leaves are thinnest, and the tip of the leaf is just disappearing in the nature. So that's the beauty of creation. Like human being, look at the hair, the finishing material. Look at the edge of your nail, it's the finishing material. So where it finishes up, it's gradually thinning up, thinning up, thinning up. And this is, you know, moves with this, and you move the wind here. So you create the dialogue. When wind comes, your hair moves. So it's a dialogue between hair and body and the wind also. So this is how I have to make my building disappear. So I put gradually thin concrete, thinning, thinning, and edged by a glass edging, so it becomes thin as possible and healthy. This water body is very shallow, it's like 8 inches deep, and below is all car parking. the next whole area is quite not that heated up. The rooftop and the courtyard on the top of the top floors. Because Chinese, they believe water should be there, and flow of water means to them is basically flow of money. Chinese are very much towards money. So they love water, so I utilize the water, their philosophy. And this is evening. So I'm always fascinated by water because I'm from a country of water. So a couple of projects we did, this landscape, like a boat floating deck. And the detailing is very important. I love the detailing. So some of the projects, I'll just go quickly what we are doing. This is one project, this where I'm so fascinated that below 45 feet, 15 meters of earth, we are putting back the water and the huge water body in the huge garden. And the whole light coming from the top of the glass, just entering into the whole area, and we are creating garden in the home of the earth. Top of the building, some of the covers, like a pavilion. So we started one interesting thing in Dhaka. If you go to Dhaka, you will see none of the buildings nowadays you will see algae and salinity, because I was dead against painting of the building, rendering with plaster and paint. Because it only absorbs water and then its capillary action, it becomes completely absorbed by water, and after 5 to 10 years, it starts pushing back the water outside and inside both. So you can see that whole dampness around, and it can't be rectified, not can't be corrected. It's not possible. Everywhere is same thing happened. So we suggested whatever the building, high rise or low rise, we can use a structural system as an exposed system, a concrete, because Bangladesh is also a seismic zone, it's a heavy seismic zone. So concrete as a beautiful facade and the infill bridge is also exposed. These both acts like a skin. It breathes actually. It takes water, it dries up when it's sunny day. It absorbs water 10%, 12%, and again it goes up. So like works like a skin. So it breathes, building breathes. So this is how we started new paradigm, you know, shifting paradigm, that putting exposed concrete and brick in field, and then layer of gardens everywhere. Layer of gardens. A very famous movie, Still Alice, probably many of you have seen, award-winning movie, where Julianne Moore acted as an Alzheimer's patient. You know, the Alzheimer's is a disease where people, a person, gradually starts losing his or her memories. And he ends up with nothing, no memories, zero memories. So that movie says how a person gradually becoming no one's thing. This is important for me, that architecture or anything you talk about is all about compilation of memories. What we do, what we write, we do architecture, we do painting, it's all about your memories. But you have accumulated memories. Now the question comes, are we creating good memories for the new generation, or are we creating devastated war situation, the memories for the new generation? As an architect, I cannot change the world, I say that, but I can create some memories for me, for other people, that they can change the memories and create something much better using the memories in the future. So, for memory, this is the old part of Dhaka where I saw my childhood, every house, there's no boundary wall. Every house is having, you see all the houses here, is having a beautiful plinth that locally we call mail. In Kolkata, I know it called rock. And we used to sit down and gossip. That's a discourse place for the young generation. And resting place, you can see the bench for the older generation. This is how the owner of the house is actually telling you that I respect you, I trust you, and have a seat in front of my bench. And the other people passerby, they feel like these people is not negating us. These people are good, they're allowing us, they're free to sit. But what we are doing now, we are designing beautiful boundary walls. We're designing high boundary walls. And then, not enough, we are putting bird poem on that. Telling people, I don't only trust you and disrespect you, I will also scratch you. And then be aware of dog sign, and my dog is there to bite you. So this is how the conversation going on in the city, and we architects are designing beautiful boundary walls to protect our owners of the house. So this is the semiology between a society. Do you think this will create a beautiful bonded society? Or it will create a fragile, vulnerable, dispersed society, not trusting each other? Probably after a few years, like America will be writing down below the dog bite, arms response, like American, the written, arm response. If you look at the house, if they suspect you, they'll shoot you. There's no rule, no court, nothing law is there. So this is where we're going actually. We thought, since we're not going to change the whole world, I change my design. I change my design of boundary wall, of apartment buildings or houses, like a beautiful sitting benches, and the lack of greenery, so put more greenery on there, and the steps, it can go ups and down without any reason. People can sit, birds can come and chirp, and you can create friendship, not only in nature, but with the house owner. So then, we started putting some extent glass boundary wall, because when the boundary wall is heavy, the bifurcation, the relationship is far, far away. Let the boundary wall fragile and vulnerable. But the society, well connected and bonded, they can see the whole ground floor, the landscape, the water body, the beautiful lives, so they are all connected. So all visible. I never saw anybody trying to break this glass. Number one is that they love it and they have a good feeling of the house owner. These people are gentlemen. And also the beautiful green, they used to see and touch the house without knowing it, they already crossed the house. And then somebody may be naughty But never try to break the glass. It's so fragile, it hurts again the guy actually. This broken glass will hurt you. So that's how zannat, nobody touches the glass. So it serves the purpose in many, many ways. So now we have already done the whole landscape on the ground level becomes part of landscape of the city, and the street becomes a living space. You go through, you feel like you're going through a nice living area. Yeah, this is the roadside. But architecture also responsibility. We're looking for a project in that dilapidated area in old town, smallest possible land, and to create something to prove to the people that architects are not only for the rich people's servant, they also can create for the general people. So this is the area where we built a small house. Very simple material, exposed concrete and brick, very economic, the parasol and the roof garden. And you see how the roof gardens and the upper level gardens coming up like a creeper, creeping up gradually. And the middle of the house, a nice small tiny courtyard where rain comes, flower grows, butterfly comes, and the wind blows almost all the house. Then another project came to us and we did it actually intentionally. To show that this is the development going on, probably not in Bangladesh, many parts of South Asia. So we picked up another small house in Kiria. We tried to create a place of the hope. The confidence development. So this is the interior and the exterior, the garden we have created over there, which is all connected from the rooms and house, like a pavilion. So in a dense, dilapidated city of old town, we sit down with a nice chair and we start thinking in such a way that a yellow harvest field and my painting inspired by the color of the harvest field, a breeze blowing over the water, a midday sun and downing and stretching this last light to a light. After the dark night, when the first light comes and touches the land and water, it actually turns into watercolor again. Watercolor turns into architecture. Architecture touched by light, actually it touches our soul. So how we proceed for this poetry? It is not that easy. We must understand the process, the hard work behind it. Bangladesh has a maxim. South facing house, south is the best. North is not like that. East should have ducks. Is the advice, and west should have a bush to stop the sunlight from the west. So this magazine is telling you the whole history of construction in a society. If we follow that simply, and the courtyard is, you know, doing the same purpose, cooling, fulfilling, and the pond beside